Oh, let's thank him. Father, we give you praise. We worship and honor you. We thank you tonight, my God and my Father, for you are a mighty God. We want to appreciate you, O Lord, for your grace and your mercy, for your loving kindness, for all God protection, for divine shield. Thank you for all the prayer requests inside this basket, O God, that you answered. We want to thank you, my God and my Father, that you heard the prayers of your children in 2021. Thank you for those you heal. Thank you for those you deliver. Thank you for those you gave babies. Thank you for those, O God, you gave new jobs. Thank you for those who gave admission. Thank you for those who carried through their exam. Thank you for successes you gave your people. Lord, we are here tonight. So thank you and to appreciate you. Thank you for those who gave new vehicles. Thank you for those who settled in their own Rehoboth. Thank you, my God and my Father, for those who established in their business. Father, for all the prayers you answered in 2021. We are here to say thank you. We are here to say thank you. We are here to say thank you. Thank you, my God and my Father. Thank you, Jehovah Jireh, for the impossibility of God. Thank you for all the impossible situations that you made possible in 2021. We thank you, Lord God. We bless your holy name. We honor you and adore you for all the prayer requests your children temple before you in 2021 that you have answered. We say thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, El Shaddai, in the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
What shall I say unto the Lord? All I have to say is thank you, Lord. What shall I say unto the Lord? Tonight to thank you. We are here tonight to appreciate you for all the prayer requests that your children tabled before you in 2021 that you heard and answered. Thank you, Almighty, All-Sufficient God, for those who healed their diseases. Thank you, my God and my Father, for those that you saved from the powers of darkness. Thank you, mighty and ever-living Savior, for those who gave babies. Thank you, Lord, for those who gave new job. Thank you, Lord, for those who settled in their own matrimonial homes. Thank you, my God and my Father, for those who gave admission into higher institutions. Thank you for those who established in their businesses. My God and my Father, we thank you for those who get promotion in 2021. Father, we honor and adore you, faithful and reliable God. We lift up your name on high, O God, for all the prayer requests your people presented before you. Daddy, you heard, on this January 2022 Covenant Seminar to say thank you, Lord. We thank you for your divine protection. We thank you for your divine shield. Many died in 2021, but Daddy, you preserved our lives. Not because of our goodness, not because of our righteousness, not because we are better than those that died, but your mercy located us. Your mercy, Rebrakandereba Shanta, Ebrikandereba Santa, Prokondorobo Shekenderia, Rebrakanderima Santoria, Brakende Bauri Batanda, Prezikayababa, Reprokonto, Brakanderia, Rekandariababa Santa. Your mercy located us, your mercy found us. And here we are tonight to return the glory to you. What a mighty God you are. What a loving Father you are. What a kind and gracious God you are. Thank you so much. Thank you for loving us, Lord. Thank you for showing us mercy. Thank you for answering our prayers. May your name forever be glorified. May your name forever be magnified. May your name forever be exalted and adored. Thank you, reliable God. Thank you, dependable God. May all the glory, may all the honor, may all adoration, thanksgiving and worship remain ascribed to you and you alone. For no man, no woman shall share your glory. All the glory will remain ascribed only to you, our Most High God. For in Jesus' name we have prayed. Amen. We are still praying. I want you to thank God that you are here tonight. And I want you to ask the Lord not to pass you by today. Tell the Lord not to pass you by. And the Lord will be touching the lives of his people. As God will be ministering to others, tell him not to pass you by. Do not harden your heart. You are not here to see any man or woman. You're not here to see any created thing. We are here to encounter the Most High God. We are here to encounter him in a special dimension tonight. Therefore, I want you to remain focused. Don't allow anybody to distract you. Don't allow anything to take your mind and your heart away. Focus on him. He is here tonight. He is here tonight. Tell him not to pass you by. Tell the Lord to hear your prayer request that you're going to present unto him today. Pray my so contoria. Every mama raba sanderina kanda. Ebra kanderabo shekende. Rima handerino so contoria. Do not pass us by tonight, O Lord. Do not pass your people by, O God. Father, touch the lives of each and every person that will be here tonight. Use each and every one of us as a point of contact to members of our families wherever they are. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you, mighty and everlasting Father. We pray for open hearts tonight, that the hearts of your people shall be opened unto you, O God, to receive from you tonight, our Most High. In the name of Jesus. We're going to pray one prayer before the man of God comes up. And you're going, that prayer is for you to decree against any powers of darkness that may want to gather against you and your family in the year 2022. The Bible said in Isaiah chapter 8, from verse 9, it said, associate yourself together for battle. You shall be shattered. Devise your strategy. It shall be thwarted. Propose your plans. It can never come to pass because the Lord our God is with us. You're going to decree tonight, because the Lord our God is with you and your household in the year 2022. Every satanic gang up against you, wherever they will associate themselves together to fight against you and your family, let God arise. Let the enemies be scattered. Open your mouth and pray. Rebramo sekenderia. Ebrakandorobo sekanda Maria. Every association of the wicked in the year 2022, wherever they will gather to conspire against your people this year, Father, we decree and declare devastation upon every satanic gathering. The Bible says, associate yourself together for battle. You shall be shattered wherever you will gather, in any satanic sanctum, in any witch's coven, in any demonic altar, to fight against our life, to fight against this ministry. The Lord God Almighty has risen against you to frustrate every of your plans and before your activities to God. In the name of Jesus, Abraham, whatever strategy that you will devise in this new year against the people of God, against the ministry, your strategy shall be thwarted in the name of Jesus Christ. Whatever plans you will propose against our life, the Bible says your plans will not stand because the Lord our God is with us. Thank you, Jesus. We worship you. Jesus has won the battle. Oh, victorious, victorious, victorious. Oh, victor. Jesus has won the battle. Oh, victorious, victorious, victorious. Oh, victor. Jesus has won. In this year, 2022, Jesus has won your battle for you. Oh, victorious, 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 oh, victorious. Oh, Jesus has won the battle.
In Jesus' name we pray. Lift up those hands and bless the name of the Lord as we sing this song. I believe that most of us know it. Oh, to turn on some more room. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah,
Thank you. Look at somebody by your side and say, oh, God's a man that we have a child.
Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name we pray. In the mighty name of Jesus. And so, Lord, we want to thank you. We want to bless your holy name. We want to honor you and adore you for yet another day, another moment it has pleased you to bring us together. The second day of the covenant seminar for 2022. A day you crafted back in eternity past. It pleased you that today we are gathered to fellowship with each other and to commune with the throne room of grace. Thou who is the great monarch of Zion, sit enthroned over this congregation. Let every contrary throne be dethroned. Open our hearts, our minds unto your counsel, and let by the entrance of your word, let there be greater depths of illumination. Sit enthroned, Lord, and as you sit enthroned, we will receive from you. We shall be careful to give you the glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hallelujah. Can you be seated, please, as you open your Bibles to Deuteronomy chapter 29. Technical team set the amplifier well. It's echoey. Deuteronomy chapter 29. God bless you, technical team. Deuteronomy chapter 29. Today is the second day of this month's program and the covenant seminar for 2022. Incidentally, we are rounding up the major part of the covenant seminar today because of the triple dose attitude of gratitude we have tomorrow. I know that many of you are still itching to hear my testimony. Don't worry, you hear it. Part of it today, and then tomorrow the one in full. Deuteronomy chapter 29, we are still continuing with our covenant program, part of the program 29, Deuteronomy chapter 29. Are we alive? If you are dead, tell me I am there. If you are not there, say I am coming. Deuteronomy chapter 29, I will read from verse 12. You are standing here in order to enter into a covenant with the Lord your God. We usually do this on the last day of the covenant seminar, but because of the program we have tomorrow, which you are all invited, that's why we are taking it today. I'll read again, verse 12. You are standing here today. I know you are sitting down. I'm the only one standing. In order to enter into a covenant with the Lord your God, a covenant the Lord is making with you this day and sealing with an oath to confirm you this day as his people, that he may be your God as he promised you and as he sworn to your fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. I am making this covenant with you, his oath, not only with you who are standing here or sitting here with us today in the presence of the Lord our God, but also with those who are not here. Praise the Lord. You are representing your family. You are representing your life endeavor. You are representing your whatever you are doing in life. Hebrews chapter 8. Hebrews chapter 8. Hebrews chapter 8. If you have been attending BTM covenant seminars, you would have noticed that I had given a teaching in the past on the different types of covenants. Not only satanic covenant, we had focused on godly divine covenants. And I said there are seven of them. The Messianic covenant, the last covenant, the covenant of the New Testament, is the one that we're operating in now. And this is part of that agreement. Hebrews chapter 8, verse 13. By calling this covenant new, that's the Messianic covenant, he has made the first one referring to the Mosaic covenant, the covenant we call the Old Testament. He has made that one obsolete. That means it has ended. Bible says that Christ is the end of the law, that's the old covenant, for those who believe. Those who have not believed, they are still operating under that yoke. And that covenant ended with a curse. It carried a curse. But this place where it is said, by calling this covenant new, he has made the first one obsolete. And what is obsolete and aging will soon disappear. And for us now, it has already disappeared. Ephesians chapter 2 confirms it, that the law, which is regulation, ended under Christ. Romans chapter 10 verse 4 confirms it also, that Christ is the end of the law of Moses for those who believe. And in Colossians chapter 2 verse 14 and 15 also confirms it. Bible said, out of the mouth of two or more witnesses a case established. I'm giving you three. Colossians chapter 2 verse 14, 15 said that he took away the handwriting of ordinances that stood opposed to us and against us. After canceling it, he canceled it. He took it to the cross and nailed it there. Means permanently settled. So we are no more operating under the old covenant. That's the Mosaic covenant. There are seven divine covenants in the Bible. There are many, many covenants, but seven of them were divinely ordained by God. The first one, which you will not see first in the Bible, the first covenant you see in the Bible is the Adamic covenant. But that is not the first. The first one is called the covenant of eternal redemption. That's the covenant Christ made with God the Father before the world began, before we were created. Christ said through the mouth, in fact, he said it himself. He said, I confer upon you a covenant which I had, a kingdom which I had covenanted with my Father before the world began. I'm quoting from Luke chapter 22, verse 29. So before we were created, God the Father and God the Son had made an agreement. And that agreement is what The Bible referred to in Philippians chapter 2, said he remained obedient. Obedient to what? Obedient to that agreement. Even death on a cross, that was the agreement that he would come to earth, become man, and die on the cross. And through that death, mankind will be redeemed. So that is the first divine covenant. The second one is the Adamic covenant God made with Adam. The third one is the Noahic covenant he made with Noah. The fourth one is the Abrahamic covenant he made with Abraham. The fifth one is the Mosaic covenant he made with Israel through Moses. That's why it's called the Mosaic covenant. The sixth one is the Davidic covenant he made with David, because David is in a special class by himself. Like yesterday, those of you who were here, I told you that David is among the three people who operated ahead of their generation. So there's a Davidic covenant. Then the last one, which encompasses, embraces, and overrides all of them, is the Messianic covenant, the one we have through Christ. So this is the one where we read in Deuteronomy chapter, Hebrews chapter 8, he said, it has made every other covenant obsolete, even the Mosaic covenant, the covenant God made with Israel through Moses. And by extension, therefore, if you come into Christ, I didn't say if you begin to go to church, if you come into Christ, if you become genuinely born again, and it's a matter of the heart, not a matter of decoration, not a matter of my church is the best, not a matter of my church is the fastest growing church, not a matter of my pastor is the best man of God in the world, no. It's a matter of the heart. The word repent means to turn around. Repent doesn't mean after going to church. Repent means to turn around. That's why in the Hebrew Bible it said, Ichiharia gemegen, gechiharia, ichiharia mi ichiharebe, if you have not repented. So it's a matter of the heart. Even if you are in the front seat in your church and they have given you all the titles, but ichiharebe, chiharia, so said, repent, change the way you think, because the kingdom of God is available. So for the kingdom of God to be available, the condition is change the way you think. That's why the Bible said in Romans chapter 12, don't conform again to the pattern of the world, but be transformed. Let me use a modern language. Let your mind be renovated. Let it be reprogrammed. Let those computer chips that was under analog change it to, what do you call it now? Digital. Eh? Praise the Lord. So let your mind be transformed. The Greek word is metamorpho, which we translate in English, metamorphosis. Wayward, like a snake who removes his old skin. And the way it happens is by the word of God. One translation said, change the way you think by allowing the word of God to change who you are. Become a new person by allowing the word of God to change the way you think. So if you don't change the way you think, you are not yet born again. But if you have done that, you have come under a new covenant, a better covenant, a superior covenant, an everlasting covenant, a covenant with better promises, a covenant that has canceled every other covenant. So any covenant by ancestral, genealogical, down the line, you are no more under that. You can only be that if you have not Chiharia and Chiharia. That's why the Bible said in John chapter 1, verse 12, he said, as many as receive him, as many as believe in his name, to them God has given the power to be called. Then verse 13 says, children, no more of human descent, no more of bloodline patterns. You are no more following the bloodline of your father or mother. You are now of the bloodline of the line of tribe of Judah. Who knows where I come from? Who knows where I come from? Can you raise your hand if you know where I come from? My sister. My sister said, Abia, I am from heaven. Hallelujah. But we were just quoting, said, if you are born again, you are no more born of human descent. You are now born of God. And he said, if you are now born of God, the seed of God is in you. The seed of Reuben, Kalumba, is no more in me. The seed that is in me is the seed of the lion of the tribe of Judah. Eh? Any lion that sees me must run away. You didn't hear what I said. I just heard sometime last year that the reason why Lions are not used for sacrifice. Their blood is bitter. Even demons don't accept the blood of lions. So you cannot use a lion to make any form of sacrifice. You can use any other animal, not lion. And so if you are from the tribe of the Lion of Judah, no demon can use you for sacrifice. No witch or wizard can use you for sacrifice in the mighty name of Jesus. So it's a better covenant. It's a superior covenant. The blood of our covenant is speaking from the third heaven. Everything any enchanter, witch, wizard, necromancer, astrologer will do on earth, the blood of ghosts and rams are speaking on the earth in shrines, in a Obu or Obi or whatever, where Ezemo or Shongo or whatever is speaking. But the blood of our covenant is speaking from the third heaven. Hallelujah. Far above every prince and principality. It is this new covenant we have come to renew today. In fact, the book of Deuteronomy, it means, the word Deuteronomy means the second reading of the law. Moses had to repeat the law again a second time, and they now renewed their covenant. Praise the Lord. Now we renew covenant based upon the Messianic platform. Hallelujah. I say hallelujah. I say hallelujah. So yesterday we looked at this my program. We looked at two angles. Number one, the angle of prophetic numerology, the meaning, the prophetic meaning of the number 2022. I told you what 20 means. I told you what 22 means, and I combined it. Number two, we look at it from the angle of what the Spirit is saying. What the Holy Spirit is saying in the now. And I remember at towards the end, I gave you six points. Praise the Lord. Today, we want to look at it from the angle of the theme. The theme is triple dose for attitude of gratitude. And then number four, we look at it from the angle of covenants. I've already made a little incursion into that. A covenant is an agreement between two or more parties where there are conditions to fulfill and promises to keep. Praise the Lord. When two or more parties come into agreement, it's called a covenant. It can be between two equal parties. I'm not going to that teaching today. I'm just trying to have an overview. Or between, you know, master-servant relationship, a bigger person and a smaller person. And there are conditions. In this case, God is the bigger person and we are the lesser person. And the conditions don't usually come from the lesser person. It comes from the higher person. So I hear people say, God, this is not my agreement with you. You don't have a right to give God condition. He's the one that gives conditions. Praise the Lord. So when you miss out anything, don't begin to say, God, this is not my agreement with you. The agreement of God is the word of God. If what you are asking God is not in tandem with his will, if it is not in the same frequency, forget it. When you are reading the Bible, you are reading the word of God. It's God talking to you. So when there is an agreement, there are conditions to keep and there are promises to fulfill. It's as you keep the conditions that God will now fulfill his promises. We'll go into all the details of the conditions needed in the New Testament because that's not our focus for today because of time. But I just want to just bring up one thing. No matter how many promises there are in the Bible, and I've given you the number before, there are 7,346 promises. They are all yea and amen in Christ Jesus, in Christ Jesus, in Christ. So for anything to be fulfilled under the new covenant, it has to be in Christ Jesus. Any promise you check, any promise in Christ Jesus, in Christ Jesus, through Christ. That's why when we pray, we say, in the name of Jesus. Because it's only by what he has done that we are qualified to receive anything from God. The second thing I just want to add under the new covenant, the summary, is just one word. And the word is obedience. In fact, all the covenants in the Bible, the key condition is obedience. If you diligently hearken, if you diligently listen, in fact, the Hebrew is double adjective. If you listen, listening. If you diligently hearken to the voice of the Lord, all these promises shall follow you. All these blessings shall accompany you. You, as you are going, they are going with you. As you are running, they pursue you. They will not allow you. But if you disobey, that's why the Bible says, I place before you today life and death, blessings and curses. Then he says, choose you. So it is you that chooses. If it is your choice, but even though it is your choice, remember the consequences are also yours. So whatever you choose, right from Eden, that's why God made it so. That's where covenants began. The tree of life, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Adam, don't touch this one. Eat this one. As much as you want. That is how it began. Our God is a God of covenants. There is nobody God has a deep relationship with outside of covenants. I will say that again. Our God, right from creation of mankind, introduced himself as a God of covenant. So any serious relationship you are having with him is not outside of covenant. Number three, our God is a covenant-keeping God. He keeps his own part of the covenant. It's only left for you to keep your own part. He's asked Jeremiah, where are your fathers? Jeremiah said, they are there. Where are your forefathers? Jeremiah said, they are there. He said, where are those prophets who disobeyed me? Jeremiah said, they are there. God said, I am God. I'm still alive. They have all gone. And he said, what did I ask them to do except to obey me? Full stop. And today, it's the same thing. It's obedience. What have I asked my children to do? Only obey. If you obey, all these 7,346 promises will follow you. Forget about all the logic. Forget about all the sweet, sweet things. Forget about all the extreme teachings. I'm not trying to criticize anybody. I'm only talking the Bible. All the extreme teachings about grace, unmerited favor. If you sin, God will forgive you. God is a God of mercy. God is a God of love. It's not true. God is a God of mercy. He's also a God of justice. And he has given us two platforms. If you obey, I will bless you. If you disobey, curse will come upon you. Full stop. If you want to be a Christian, be a Christian. If you don't want to be a Christian, nobody will kill you. But the consequences are yours. If you have ever tested this thing called hell, by the grace of God, even though God did not take me to hell, but some years ago, God took me to a place called, I want to call, outer darkness. My sister, my brother, is a location of hopelessness. When I came out of that vision, I promised myself and God, may I never find myself there. May anybody I love never find himself or herself there. I don't know how hell itself will be. I saw two people when I visited that place I refer to as outer darkness. I know them. Then one person is late, one person is alive. In fact, that person is in this hall now. But I don't want to mention names. And there were things that I saw about them. And then I told myself, I have to pray for this, my two brothers. It's not a place. By the grace of God also, sometime between 1989 and 1990, God took me to a place I believe is a part of heaven. It's a wonderful place to be. In fact, when I came back to the physical, my body was like sugar, 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 if you understand what I mean. I thank God, why did you bring me back that fast? Why allow me to be there? You won't even feel the weight of your body. Heaven is real. Hell is also real. And permit me, even though I didn't have all this in my outline, but I'm talking as the Spirit is leading me. I've given this testimony many times. Permit me if you have heard it many times from my mouth. It happened 40-something years ago, 1975. That's 45 years ago when I found myself in the medical college for the first time. A Nyanyosu cadaver to court. It was the first subject, anatomy. Our professor was an Indian, an unbeliever, Professor Lassen. He said, I know some of you are Christians. No problem with me. On Sunday, go to church, but come back. But every day from Monday to Sunday, you must come to the anatomy lab and cut your own cadaver 8 hours. There will be somebody there to mark for you. For 15 months, you must come there every day. Any day you don't come, you will not be marked. And you have to score a particular percentage. We didn't know what that meant. He said, attendant, bring the specimen. And the attendant brought one trolley. All of us were looking at the trolley, looking. We didn't know. He said, remove the tarpaulin. He removed the tarpaulin. And we saw it was a dead body. Some jumped through the window. Thank God it was ground floor. It wasn't first floor, second floor. Some ran away through the door. We were about 250 something. I can't remember, 256. The only people remaining in the hall were not up to 10. I didn't run. I'm not saying it in pride. The reason why I didn't run, I had seen dead bodies during the Nigerian-Biafran war. So I wasn't frightened. It was when the man said, anybody who will come and touch this thing with ordinary hand will be my friend for these 15 months. All of us kept quiet. He didn't say, wear your glove. So we're there. One girl, I remember, what's that her name? One little girl, they just walk, said, not be this thing. So touch the thing. Some boys say, if girl touch her, me, I go touch her also now. So a few boys went there and touched it. We thought that will be the end. That at the beginning of the course, Professor Lassie will come and be cutting and will be looking. He said, shift, come out from the wall. We didn't know that all these trolleys are close to the one with dead bodies. So when we now say, remove the tarpaulin, we now saw they were dead bodies. He said, you, that's your own. You, that's your own. You. Two students to one dead body. He said, you have to cut it not the way you want. You have to follow the manual. 4 weeks for this hand, use 1 week to revise with this hand. 4 weeks for this leg, use 1 week to revise before you begin to come to the body, before you come to the head. 15 months, no other subject apart from anatomy and pathology where you do autopsy. Because you have to deal with dead bodies before you deal with live bodies. My partner ran away that day. The person that, you know, I was given to partner with me, and he said, I didn't see him again until we finished. So I was alone with this godo man. Every day, for 2.5 weeks, I didn't touch the thing. I will come to the lab, I will wear my lab coat, I will put on my gloves, I will take my scalpel, I will open the cadaver, but I will be looking at it. After some time, I will cover it. I will walk away. For about 2.5-3 weeks, why was I doing that? I would look at it and say, was this thing a human being? Was there any time this man that I'm looking at have been given legal right to cut him by the provost and given authority by the Senate, authority by the federal government? If a policeman comes in there, he will not do anything. This thing I can kick, I can spit upon, I can carry and throw, I can do. Was he once upon a time a human being? And that day I'll come. After looking at it, I asked that same question. Later, I asked a second question. This thing that is here now, where is the real person? This thing that I can do what I want to. The man who was occupying it, who may have even stopped my sister on the road and said, who are you? Do you know who I am? If you talk nonsense, I lock you up. Where is the real person? The third question that will cross my mind, I said, when he was alive, when he was on earth, what did he decide? Because it is what he decided on earth that to determine the answer to the second question. And today we are alive. Today we're on planet Earth. Today we have this choice. We can follow the satanic covenants of our ancestors who drew crooked lines. And we have grown up to see that the crooked lines they drew did not help us, has not helped till now. We can give it any wonderful name, culture and tradition. We can cover it up and paint it white. It has not given us anything good. Can't we draw straight lines? Can't we make up our mind and say these things that our ancestors, Bible says in the book of 1 Peter, it said, the impossible way to heaven that our ancestors introduced. Bible said it's an impossible way to heaven. What we call tradition and culture is it cannot lead you to heaven. So covenant is not just a matter of writing your prayer requests and dropping like we usually request. It's a matter of being serious. It's a matter of the heart. God gave man everything in the world, asking man for just one thing. What was that one thing? Your heart. That was the only thing God wanted from man. Give me your heart. Proverbs repeated it. My son, my daughter, give me your heart. God is not asking you. God is not asking me for any of the only heart. Your heart. My child, give me your hand. Man push away God and brought in things. Those things, plural, we brought in. That's what is causing problem in our life. That's what James meant to say. What is causing this strife, this hypertension, this stress, this worry, this quarreling, this rivalry? He said, is it not the thing struggling in your heart to take first place? We pushed on God. We brought in things. Like I have given this testimony before. Then neighbor, I'm sure some of you, if not all, some of you may have had children. You said, or as a pastor, as an elder, as a deacon, as a deaconess, you cook one small girl, misbehaving. God, boy, I say, come, leave that boy. You're thinking, if I leave him, I will die. Have you heard such a thing before? If I leave her, I will die. Eh? That thing has taken that root in your heart. You have pushed out God. You have made that boy, that girl, God. And you said, if you leave him or her, you will die. No. God said, my son. So if you are renewing covenant, you are saying, God, take my heart. Be number one. This was the test God gave to Abraham. Bible said in Genesis chapter 22 that God tested Abraham. What was the test? Verse 1 begins with, after all these things. So what are the all these things? The answer is chapter 21. Because where I quoted is verse 1 of chapter 22. Chapter 21 gives us the answer to after these things. What are these things? Abraham now got Isaac. From the moment I'm rising, Abraham stopped building altars. Check it in the Bible. Abraham was a man of the altar. Abraham was practicing priesthood, which is very important for every child of God. Immediately Isaac came to be. Abraham, you will not see Abraham building altars again until this chapter 22. Number two, quarrel came into Abraham's house. Sarah and what's her name? Hagar. And Abraham was now confused who is to side. Would I side Sarah or would I side Hagar? Number three, Abraham that was ready to do anything to glorify God. Abimelech came with his commissioners and ministers to say, we have heard that your God is wonderful God. Instead of Abraham seizing that opportunity to preach the good news, Abraham said, leave God alone. They say something important. Abimelech said, what's that? They say, there's one well I dug, your servants have taken it. Abraham began to struggle for one well. Instead of preaching the good news to a hidden king, Abraham now forgot this God and began to no more intercession, no more altars, quarrel in the family, rivalry, strife, whatever it is. And then now Abraham, this was Abraham that told Lord, if you want west, take west. If you want east, take just even though you are my younger brother's son. But Abraham now began to struggle for one well. Number four, Abraham went and got a tamarisk tree. Now, leave why not boy or two. He made the market boundary. Bible said he planted a tamarisk tree to protect the land he bought for his son Isaac. Abraham Abdawala. So this was why this was the test. God now said, Abraham, sir, take your son. Yes, sir. Your only son. The one you love so much. Let me tell you the meaning. The one that has taken my place in your heart. That was the meaning. Abraham, that your son that has now taken the prime place in your heart, go and sacrifice him for me. That was the test. Thank God Abraham said, yes, sir. That was where he passed the test. God now said, I now swear, as for blessings, I will bless you. As for multiplication, I will multiply you. This is the test. And so as we are renewing covenant, that is the primary thing we have in our heart. It's not a matter of writing 100 prayer points. We just prayed over the prayer request of last year, thanking God. We're going to make another one today. So it's not a matter of writing prayer. It's a matter of the heart. And if you allow me, let me remind you of another testimony. In a convention, you know, a very large convention. The time for the next speaker to speak had not reached. So the person who was coordinating came up the rostrum and said, I just have a meeting to fill up the time. Is anybody here who has a special number, testimony? Every place was quiet. He said, I have a very strong feeling there's somebody in the hall who has a special number, a testimony. One old man eventually raised his hand. The speaker, it was a full gospel businessman convention somewhere in the U.S. The speaker who was giving this testimony, the man who wrote Beck's Concordance, is the person who gave this testimony. He was speaker that day. He said, anyway, he became annoyed. Because he said that day he had prepared. And the anointing was upon him. And the hall was full. He was waiting to be introduced. Big man of God from... My mouth shut up. I wanted to say Kogiriko, but my mouth shut up. But when they called up this papa to come and give whatever, the speaker became annoyed. But the papa now made it worse. He stood up, old retired man. He took all the time. Instead of walking briskly, old man, he shuffled. So this speaker said he was annoyed. How can this woman be wasting my time? The man came up. Instead of, he said, I have a special number. Instead of singing, he began to tune his banjo. Banjo is a local type of guitar. Spent time correcting the strings. When he had spent all the time, he said, I have a partner who will sing with me. He called up another papa. That papa also took all the time. So when the enemy wants to undo you, he makes sure you use every card in the game. And when God also wants to test you, it was with little things, minor things. Can you imagine God setting an exam with how to drink water? 33,000 people got down to 13,000, got down to 10,000. He said, carry them for one day. There are too many. What did he use to separate them? How to drink water? 9,700 failed. Only 300 passed. Because the other people will come and, boo, God said, no, you cannot fight war. But those who were still sharp and they knelt down to lap water, God said, this won't go. So God tested this man with anger. The man said he was boiling. So the second person came, tuned his banjo also. Then they began to sing. This one will sing off key. This one will sing off chord. The one will sing on to, let me sing soprano. He said, sing treble, let me sing. And this man of God said he got so much annoyed. He knew when the power of God left him. He said he knew, not that he didn't know. But instead of saying, God, I'm sorry, he kept on allowing the anger to boil up. The same anger that pulled down Moses. Then he heard a voice behind him, just like this place is flat, no window. He heard a voice that said, shut up. He said he looked around, didn't see anybody. The coordinator was on the pulpit. The head table, people were sitting down there. He knew it was not from any of them. The voice said again, shut up. He said, God, is that you? The voice said, yes, it's me. So God now asked him, why are you annoyed? He said, God, you should know now. These people are wasting my time. I want to dish out what you have given me. God said, shut up. You are judging those men by the judgment of man. But I have judged them by the judgment of heaven. Even though what they are singing is not sweet to your ears, but I have looked at their heart. And their heart is what I want. They are not singing to impress anybody. They are singing to glorify me. And because for this moment, I have seen two hearts that are in alignment with what I want. I, God, I have ordered the heavenly choir to stop singing for 5 minutes. Let me hear this to them. Can you imagine God? The Bible said that the angels in heaven, they sing 24 hours. But when God saw two men, whose hearts were right, whose hearts were exactly what he wanted, he said, heavenly choir, I am now vetoing your choral district. Stop singing for 5 minutes. Let me hear this. My brother, my sister, what's in your heart? Even as we have come to renew covenant, what is in your heart? Can I repeat? It's not a matter of just writing, you know, prayer requests. The second part of this, so that we can now begin to pray, hallelujah, attitude for gratitude. What is attitude? There are many, many definitions. Praise the Lord. But before we go into that, can you close your eyes for a minute? Can you close your eyes for a minute? Ask yourself, what's in my heart? As I have come before God to renew covenant with Him this new year, what is in my heart? What is in my heart? What choice am I making? What choices? Is it something to glorify man, to defy myself, or to lift up God? Talk to the Lord. Talk to the Lord. My son, my daughter, give me your heart. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Can you look up now? Let me just mention the second part, then we can pray. Attitude, I just got about four definitions. Attitude means the culture, a habit of, the thing you do always. Your tendency towards something, your disposition, that's what we call attitude. How do you feel about something? Praise the Lord. Your inclination is a way of life. It's not what you do once in a while. So what is your attitude generally? Then the word gratitude, I picked up one meaning relevant to what we are sharing. Gratitude means a feeling of thankfulness and appreciation. So what is your attitude towards life? What's your attitude towards what God has been doing in your life? Let me take that again. Attitude is a culture, a habit, a way of life. Gratitude is a feeling of thankfulness and appreciation. You can only be thankful and appreciative if you understand the why and the how and the what. Even our salvation, if you don't understand what salvation is all about, then you take it for granted. My wife wrote a book. I'm sure some of you have read that book. Do not play with your salvation. If you have not read that book, it's very small and it's cheap. Of all the books of this, the cheapest, 100 naira, is it 150? Go and read that book. It's not too big, so you can finish it in a day. Salvation is free, but it was not cheap. Our salvation is free. God gave it to us free, but it was not cheap. It cost God His best. It cost God His highest. It cost God His loveliest. And the testimony I usually like using to describe it, I want to repeat so that we can bring everything into context. It's a man that had an only son, praise the Lord, an only son whose heart was fine. And the man loved the son, well-behaved boy, no problem with the boy. The only child and the only son. One day, somebody came and cut off his head for nothing. Somebody just came and killed the child. So the question I asked the first time I shared this testimony, I heard it from a brother, what was his name again? So there are four options. Number one, vengeance. The father of the son had the first option of vengeance. Since he was of noble character, he had the authority. Go and bring that man who killed my only son. Cut off his head. It's tooth for tooth, eye for eye. That's the first option. But this man did not do that. The second option, we call it justice. Go and report him to the government. The government authorities, they will investigate. And they are going to find out that my son didn't do him any wrong. He just killed him for nothing. And then they can say the man, because you've shed innocent blood, you go to the gallows. That is what we call justice. So this man had the option of vengeance, but he refused to take it. He had the option of justice, go and report that he refused to take it. The third option was forgive the man. Your only child, somebody killed him. How is it easy to forgive? But assuming he had accepted that option, that's what we call mercy. Mercy is you merited to be killed, but I'm saying, Habu, I forgive you. I even forget about it. And for us, in our salvation, God did not just forgive and forget. He said, your sins I will remember no more. And the Bible asks another one, justification. Just as if you have not sinned. Not only will I not remember it anymore, I will not even think about that you ever committed it. But this man also refused that one. this man, Eburunwaya, he chose a fourth option. He not only forgave the man who killed his son, he took the man and said, I had estates I had left for my son. I had landed property I left for my son. Not only am I forgiving you, I am giving you his position. I'm giving you his possession. That is what we call grace. God did not just forgive us. He gave us his son's position, his status, his power, his possession. He made us joint heirs, not junior heirs, joint heirs. If Christ has 100%, we have 100%. That is grace. God's riches at Christ's expense. God gave us salvation at the expense of Christ. No wonder he said, because he remained obedient, even obedient unto death, even death on a cross. That was the agreement. Remember when I mentioned the seven divine covenant, I mentioned the first one as covenant of eternal redemption. I confer upon you a kingdom that I had covenanted with my father before the world began. That agreement had been made. Salvation is free, but it wasn't cheap. It cost God a lot. So if you understand even what salvation is, then like I quoted that book, you won't play with it. May not help us to understand and appreciate in Jesus' name. So when you are talking of God's grace, it's not what people preach, extreme grace. Bible said in Titus chapter 2, grace teaches us to say no to every form of sin. Grace is not do what you want, God will forgive you. No, that's not grace. May not help us to understand in Jesus' name. Not that Christ is going to die for us in future. Not that he may die for us as a probability. Not that he's even struggling now to die for us. He has already died. And the price he paid was, still is, and ever will be total, complete, permanent, for all time, for eternity. It has satisfied every aspect of divine justice. Everything divine justice demanded, that death satisfied it. And so how do we respond? I'll mention seven things we begin to pray. Praise the Lord. Number one, if you are celebrating something, if you have to be appreciative, if you have to show thanksgiving and appreciation for what God has done in your life, I'm only using salvation as a contact point, as a study case. Seven things. Number one, what happened? That's the first question. That's what you are asking yourself. What happened? Or you want to tell people, like tomorrow, those of you who have been itching to hear my testimony, come tomorrow. Be the first to come. What happened? People, for example, celebrate birthdays. But instead of, remembering what happened, they go into parties. Sometimes those parties are orgies, debauchery, drunkenness, every form of immorality. That's not how to have a memorial. If you want to have a memorial, what is your testimony? In those days, they will set up a stone. They will set up a pillar. They will set up a monument. They will pour oil upon it. Sometimes they will make a sacrifice. So because of our time, do you have a memorial in your life? Do you have a testimony in your life? If you have a testimony, what do you use to remember it? Do you show thanksgiving and appreciation? Do you have an attitude, a habit of appreciating what God has done for you? Let me, using that point of birthday, I will use Joshua, my son's birthday. His birthday is 29th of October, 19000. Don't ask me. So, what happened? So, anytime you want to show appreciation and thanksgiving, an attitude of gratitude, question number one, what happened? Question number two, or question number one, what is it? Question number two, what happened that is making you to recognize it is worthy to be grateful? Let me see you, Joshua's birth. Joshua, the day that the labor for Joshua, reached, with our medical background, she noticed some signs, and she had done nursing and midwifery, so she noticed signs that showed her no ruler, and thank God she had, and she has a husband that has medical background. He told me, man, it's like this baby is trying to come out. So I said, okay, you are the nurse, I'm the doctor, so let me do the examination. So I examined, I saw that the mouth of the womb was dilated, that's opening, preparing. So I said, okay, let's go to hospital. And the degree to which it has dilated, the maximum is 10 cm. By 3, 4, 5 cm, it's already, you can calculate next 1 or 2 hours that I'm going on. So that was my estimation. So we began to move to Mata. She trained in Mata, so they knew her there. We landed there. So she encouraged me to go back to the car and stay, instead of staying with her, because she said that she'd go home. She's a nurse. The nurses, they know her. The doctors, they know her. I didn't have anything to worry. I said, no, I wanted to stay. She said, no, go. But as I was walking back, the Lord prompted me. I went back and said, I'm not going. So I told her, I will be in the car. I had an urge to be praying. So I went to the car, straightened the chair, and began to pray. After 1 hour, they didn't call me. After 2 hours, by my human arithmetic, they didn't call me. So I went down to the neighborhood room. The dilatation had not progressed beyond that. 3 hours, 4 hours. Then I confirmed that something was wrong. So God helped me to increase my prayer point. And she was the only case in the labor room that night. So at a point in time, I had a very strong urge to go to the labor room. I can even know they would have allowed me, but I stayed at the corridor. If you know Mata labor room, after you go down, as I stayed there, I was praying. While I was praying, I saw an open vision, a skeleton, not something that looked like. I saw a skeleton, the spirit of death, walking towards the labor room. And my wife was the only woman in there. So who was that skeleton going to? What was he going there? Going there to do. I now knew why God wanted me to stay. So not just what happened, how it happened. That's how you put a memorial. So immediately I saw the skeleton. It wasn't a dream. It was not simple vision. It was an open vision. And the skeleton was wearing a cowboy hat. So immediately he came down that step, turned around, and saw me. It was like the expression of the face, why is this man here? That's the expression. Why is this man here? I saw that expression, so I pointed towards it. God laid something in my heart. Can't even remember what it was. Just pointed. I just verbalized that thing. It exploded. Immediately, the thing exploded before my eyes. Joshua came out of the womb with a clenched fist. Man of war. Victory. That's why we gave him, or part of why we gave him that name, Joshua. So Joshua is not just a name. Joshua is prophetic, and Joshua is a memorial. Am I talking to somebody? What happened? How did it happen? Number three, who made it to happen? So when you want to express an attitude of gratitude, who made it happen? Because of time, God will always tell Israel, I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt. Is that in your Bible? He can see one chapter, he will say it 4 times. He was using it to remind them that it is me, God, that did it. I am the Lord, your God, who brought you out of Egypt. 2021, most of us passed through Egypt. Am I talking to somebody? Who did it? I am the Lord, your God, who brought you out of Egypt. I don't know the Egypt you passed through in 2021. This 2022 will begin with an attitude of gratitude. An attitude of appreciation and thanksgiving. I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt. If you read the book of Ezekiel, there are two commonalities there. You always see Ezekiel referred to as son of man. Is that in the Bible? Small letter S. 100 times I've taken time to count it. The other thing you will see, the common they said, so that they will know that I am the Lord. Capital letter L, capital O, capital R, capital D is different from capital letter L, O, R, O, the small letter. That's Adonai, master. But capital letter L, capital O, capital R, capital D say El Shaddai, beg your pardon, El Gibor, man of war, captain of the heavenly host, commander-in-chief of the armies of heaven, who has never lost any battle before. He cannot lose any battle. I am the Lord, your God, so that they will know I am God. Isaiah said, so that men will know, the psalmist also said, so that men will know that God is above the affairs of man. God is above the affairs of man. Don't fail to come to, for the testimony tomorrow. If you hear what the enemy wanted to do against your brother's life and how God fought the battle, you will know truly that Jehovah, he is God. He came from an angle that even medical science could not detect what was wrong. When we were going to Enugu, we didn't know why God made us to go to Enugu. I was asked to go and do an ECG, but my ECG machine in Mata has fallen. So my wife said, we cannot stay. What will I tell people that my husband was down and just because of ECG, we are going to Abakaliki. Then we heard that doctors were on strike. She said, let's go to Enugu. I agree with her. We didn't know it was God sending us to Enugu, which was when we got there, they discovered that what medical science had diagnosed was not the problem. Am I talking to somebody? And why did God do it? So that men will know that I am the Lord. I am El Gibor. I am almighty, all-sufficient, all-powerful God. God, I told you that God just needs to introduce one variable in your situation and the enemy will be flawed. Just one variable. And for me, tomorrow when you come, I will tell you what that one variable was. Every trick that the enemy wanted to use to make R.I.P. over my life, heaven said, his time is not yet up. Am I talking to somebody? Look at the neighbor and say, neighbor, are you the one? Are we waiting for another? If you were not here yesterday, you would not understand. Hallelujah. Point number three. Who did it? And that's what we're talking. Deuteronomy chapter 20, verse 4. Because of time, our prophet said, I am the Lord your God who goes ahead of you to fight your battles and to give you victory. I am the Lord your God who goes ahead of you to fight your battles and to give you victory. Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 18. I am the Lord your God who gives you the ability to create. So whatever you think it is God. Point number four. Why he did it? Praise the Lord. Does anybody have King James? Exodus chapter 18. King James, technical team, can you read King James for me? Exodus chapter 18. That's the fourth point. I said seven, begin to pray. Exodus chapter 18. So whenever you see my son Joshua, you call him Joshua. Don't just call him that. It's a name. It's prophetic. And it's a memorial. May the Lord help us to understand in Jesus' name. Deuteronomy chapter 18, are we there? Verse number 10 and 11. He said, praise be to the Lord who rescued you from the hand of Egyptians and of Pharaoh, and who rescued the people from the hand of the Egyptians. Now I know that the Lord is greater than all the other gods, for he did this to those who had treated Israel arrogantly. Can I hear it from the King James? King James, please. King James, Exodus chapter 18, verses 10 and 11. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Okay, let's go to point number five. Okay, King James. Blessed be the Lord who delivered you out of the hand of it, and out of the hand of Pharaoh. Read, finish the last part. Hallelujah. In everything which they behave proudly, God was that's why he does it. Point number five. What is our appropriate response? Praise the Lord. Psalm 50. Appropriate response. I'm rounding up now so that we can pray. Psalm number 50. Appropriate response. When there's a memorial in your life, when there is something to show attitude for gratitude, and our own is threefold. Remember, we are celebrating the 31st anniversary of BTM. Tomorrow is this weekend, is exactly 31 years God called us out of our former profession. And then we are dedicating this Ezekiel Center. You can see some little coloring or painting. Hallelujah. And then number three, we want to give testimony of what God did. Are we there in Psalm chapter 50? Are we there in Psalm 50? Verse 23. He who sacrifices thanks offering. When you say sacrifice, means you have thanked God, you have thanked him, you have thanked him and thanked him. Keep on thanking. That's a sacrifice. He who sacrifices thanks offering honors me. Whenever you sacrifice thanks offering unto God, number one, you are honoring him. Number two, and he prepares the way so that I may show him the salvation of God. So whenever you respond appropriately, you are doing two things. Number one, you are honoring God. Number two, you are opening the way for him to come and show you another thing. So whenever you are showing an attitude of gratitude, you are not only honoring God, recognizing it is God that did that thing in your life. And I'm sure if we had time to give us opportunities, 2021 was horrible for many people, including Christian homes. I'm sure you have a testimony. You have an Egyptian voyage you passed through in 2021. And God said, the reason why you should express an attitude of thanksgiving and appreciation, number one, to honor him. Number two, when you are doing that, you are opening the way for him to come and show you bigger things. When you begin to rejoice in what God has done for you, you are saying, God, come and do more for me. Hallelujah. My wife gave a testimony the other time, and permit me to summarize it. A man, I can't remember, somebody was taken to heaven, and he was taken, among other things, shown two different rooms. In one room, he saw activity, angels moving, activity. In another room, he just saw few angels moving. So he asked the angel that was escorting him or her, can't remember, said, what's the difference? He said, in the first room, all the activities are angels receiving prayer requests from people on earth for God. So everybody, prayer requests. But the second room, only few are thanking God. That's why the angels, they are bored. Every day we say, God, do this for me, do this for me. Remember my school field. Remember my blah, 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 blah. But when it comes to thanking God, how many of us, look at the 10 lepers who Christ said, go and wash yourself in the pool called, what was the name of that pool? And the Bible said, as they were going, they discovered that they were healed. If you know anything about leprosy, leprosy will eat away your fingers. Leprosy will eat away your toes. Leprosy will eat away your eyelids, even your lips. Your teeth will be open. So they got healed. The leprosy was healed. But only one person went back and said, Lord, I want to come and thank you. And the Lord said, is there nobody in Israel apart from this Samaritan? And the Bible now says something important, very, very small clause. And the Lord said, go, you have been made whole. What's the difference? The other ones were healed of leprosy. But this one made whole. The fingers came out. The toes came out. The eyelids came out. Am I talking to somebody? He went and said, thank you. The Lord said, you are not only healed, you are made whole. So when you sacrifice thanks offering unto the Lord, number one, you are honoring him. Number two, you are opening the way and say, God, come and do more for me. Don't begin with grumbling. Don't begin this year with complaining. Don't begin this year with comparing yourself with another. I have made this illustration many, many times. If you are shorter than me, if you are taller than me, 1-0. I am shorter than you, 1-1. Okay? If you are more handsome than me, I'm uglier than you, 2-2. If you are rich and I'm poor, 3-3. So you have certain things better than me. I have certain things better than you. So don't look at the one other people have. Look at what you have. Two people were drinking wine, you know, in a restaurant, and they started at the same time. They had consumed half. One was sighing. Adrian was wrong. He said, this wine just remained half bottle. The other one was rejoicing. What happened? He said, at least I see half bottle of wine left. Hallelujah. The same half bottle of wine. So how do you look at life? How do you appreciate life? This is a true story. One day, one man killed himself. Now, in London, there's a river called Thames River, and there's a bridge called Thames Bridge. Somebody committed suicide in one end of the bridge, and he left a suicide note. What was there? He said he is owing £500,000, so he killed himself. The same night, as God will allow it, another person committed suicide, that same bridge, the other end. What was the problem? He wrote a suicide note. He said his money has come down to £500,000 that he's getting poor. So he killed himself. He didn't even understand what I said. One person killed himself because his money was remaining £500,000. The other person killed himself because he was owing £500,000. I wish now they can't weigh £500,000. They don't need a cause. One girl left Eastern region and went to Kaduna to stay with her aunt. Why? Because she felt she was not making it here. She felt everybody has to go to, like a brother said, salvation, blessing is not from abroad, it's from where? Above. So she went to Kaduna, stayed with Auntie AAA. Let me not call her name. Then unfortunately for her, she was shot and she was put to sleep in one room with her niece, who was beautiful and tall. After some time, she fell sick. The aunt was asking her, what's wrong? She couldn't say. Because all one night, the lady, you know, and by the lady of the Lord, went into the room and saw her. She would stay awake all through the night doing what? When she was lying close to her knees, she would say, ah, God, if I was as tall as Angela. So she would move up. Then she would look that the leg is longer. Then she would move down again, move down. She would look and say that she would keep on doing that throughout the night. Bible said, why worry? Will your worry add one inch to your height? No. Attitude of appreciation. Where my wife read Psalm 103. Praise the Lord, O my soul, and do what? And forget not all his benefits. Who forgives all your sins? Who heals all your diseases? Who redeems your life from the pit? Who crowns you with love and with compassion? Who satisfies your desires with good things? Who makes you to eat from the abundance of his soul? And so on and so forth. Praise the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits. Bible said in Philippians chapter 4, don't be anxious for anything. But with what? But with what? Huh? And Florence is the only person who has been answering questions yesterday. He said, with thanksgiving in your heart, make your request known to God. What does it mean? Before you pray, thank God first. He said, don't be anxious for anything, but with thanksgiving in your heart, then you make your request. When you thank God and make your request, the answer is that God will give you peace. Is that in your Bible? That peace is to show you I have arrived. How does it work? Bible said God inhabits the praise of his children. Try it. Years ago, at the early stages of the BTM ministry, God woke me up and said, my son, can you just praise me for 30 minutes every night? I said, yes, sir, without even knowing what was going to happen. So every night at a particular time, I wake up, I would just praise God for 30 minutes. It became routine for me. Every night at that time, somebody would tap me. The Holy Spirit would tap me. I wake up, I'll praise God for 30 minutes. I discovered after some 6 months that I never made one petition. I never made one supplication. I never made one intercession. It was just praising God. But there was nothing that I needed that God did not solve. Then one night, while I was doing that, I noticed some presence. I now looked and saw that there were beings in the room with me. I now saw that there were angels. I saw another batch of angels. I saw another batch of angels. And they formed a corridor. Then this scripture came into my heart. God inhabits the praise of his children. So God told me that my praise was rising like an incense and forming a corridor for him to come and brood over me. Am I talking to somebody? So when you are raising an incense of praise and worship, God comes down to brood over you. And when he's brooding over you, Psalm 9 verse 3 says, in his presence, your enemies will turn back, they will stumble, they will fall. You have not done any warfare. It's just that you are praising God. Psalm 16 verse 11, in my presence, there's what? Fullness of joy. You are just praising God. Psalm 31 verse 20, in my presence, the accusing finger will fall. The mouth that gossips against you will close. You have not done any fire. Psalm 91, he who dwells in the secret place of the Lord shall do what? Abide under the shadow of the Almighty. Shadow is protection. That the arrow that flies by day, the vessel that stalks at night, the plague that destroys at noonday, including coronavirus, they will not touch you. Am I talking to somebody? What are you doing? Just praising God. Just thanking God. Attitude of gratitude. Tell your neighbor, attitude of gratitude. Psalm 114, Bible said, the Red Sea saw something and parted. The whole Red Sea, bowels are born. That the Jordan saw something and ran away. That the mountains began to run like lambs. And then he asked rhetorically in verse 3, why was it, O Red Sea, that you parted? Why was he old Jordan that he turned back? The answer is at the presence of the Lord. So just that you are praising God, just that you are praising God, every Jordan blocking your path will run away. Just that you are praising God, mountains, problems will run away. Just that you are praising God, small problems will run away. Am I talking to somebody? From today, you shall have an attitude of what? Show thanksgiving and appreciation. This was what Jehoshaphat did. In fact, the only time an army was going to battle and choristers were in front, God told them, let the soldiers go come from behind. Let the choristers go in. As the choristers were in front and worshiping and singing, and the Bible said the army, the enemy began to kill each other. And that was the first of the battles that Israel fought. Not one soul was lost. Not even one soul was lost. Tell your neighbor, attitude of gratitude. One more time, attitude of gratitude. So number six, anytime you're having a memorial, it's a season of praise and worship. Because of time, 6 o'clock, in La Soda, we can pray. It's also a season of giving, not just thanksgiving, but giving of your love. When people hear of giving, they usually think of money, because many ministers have made giving only a money matter. You don't just give money. You can give love. You can show mercy. You can give of your time. You can give of so many things. One brother in Umahia, it's of the full gospel. I went for a program in Umahia, you know, one of the chapters. My daughter, she was still in Umudike with my son, Chimdeman. So they came for the program, a major program. I didn't go with my car. Okay, I went with my car, but they told me to leave it in the hotel. So for the hall, the program, my car was. So Njo, one of the officers, whether he can drop my children in school before he drops me in the hotel. So as we were going, he begged me, because he wanted to put on the gem for his family before we go. Brother Choma, he gave this testimony openly, you know, so I'm free to share his name. And then he now began to tell me that I don't understand. I said, no. He said, they got married for 15 years, no issue. 15 solid years, no issue. But God told him, if he shows an attitude of giving, then he will bless him. And like I said, giving is not just money. You can give love. You can give advice. When you see that girl misbehaving, don't just begin to say, why not call that girl and give her advice? So this man decided with the wife that they'll be taking care of other people's children. So they began to pick people's children to train. Even though you see children, they are living in Umahia. You won't even know they are not their children. So one day, all the money they were spending, Ghana or Abuja, Ghana, Lagos, Ghana, IUF, and Kankame. But when they say, God, we leave it to your hand, that's when God told them, just give. Give of your love. Give of your substance. So while they were doing that, God allowed 1 year to pass so that a guy has no grand Hannah. By the second year, the woman took him. A few months after that, 9 months, she delivered twins, two bouncing baby boys. So when they were giving love to other people's children, God prepared. So a time of memorial, a time of showing gratitude, is a time of giving. Give of your love, give of your time, give of your advice. Let us pray. Talk to the Lord. Talk to the Lord. Talk to the Lord. Jesus is the miracle. He's the miracle. Jesus is the miracle. Your name. Hallelujah. Only put your trust in him. He will never let you down. Jesus is the miracle you need. Oh yeah, Jesus is the miracle. Oh yeah, he is the miracle. Jesus is the miracle you need. Hallelujah. Today, put your trust in him. He will never let you down. Jesus is the miracle. The miracle you need. There was a widow whose son was dead. And to her, all hope was gone. But all the crying could not give her any joy. On her way to the cemetery, she met the Master Jesus, and he said, daughter, wipe away your tears, and the miracle you need, oh yeah.
Jesus
is a miracle. He is a miracle.
Jesus
is a miracle. Hallelujah.
Only put your trust in him. He will make the way to them.
Jesus is a miracle. The miracle you need. I say, there was a window
whose son was dead.
Come to high,
our Lord was God.
My son, give me your heart. My daughter, give me your heart. It's a heart matter. It's a matter of the heart. What is in your heart? The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 3, verses 16, 17, 18, 19, it said, who were they that fell in the desert? Was it not the people that God promised would take to the promised land? He said, who were they that died? Was it not the same people that God made a pledge to? Who were they that were beaten by the serpent and they died? The same question. Then he asked a very important question. Why couldn't they enter? If God made that promise, if they had been baptized in the Red Sea, if they had taken communion in Sinai, the manna and the water in Rephidim, that was their communion. If they had seen the power of God, their own baptism of the Holy Spirit in Mount Sinai, why couldn't they enter? The Bible answers that same question in verses 10 and 11. He said, number one, because they didn't know my ways. Number two, because their heart was always going astray. See, the reason why they couldn't enter, their hearts were going astray. They didn't understand the ways of the Lord. They thought it was just Igbo, Igbo, we are Israelites. We are children of Abraham. Bible said God showed his miracles to Israel, but he showed his way to Moses. Israel saw miracles, but they still perished. Moses knew God's ways. Moses said, if I have found favor before you, since you say you know me by name, show me your way so that I will continue to find favor. Moses did not ask for house or wife or children or husband or car or promotion. He said, show me your ways. If you show me your ways and I know them, then I will continue to find favor before you. Let the rich man not boast of his wealth. Let the strong man not boast of his strength. Let the wise man not boast of his wisdom. Let him who boasts of this one thing, that he knows the Lord. And what does he say? He knows the way of the Lord. If you know his ways, then everything will fit in properly. I'm sorry that we have to raise it because tomorrow is on a class of his own. We usually do this for 3 days. So the third day that we specifically used to do the covenant prayers, but we are compressing everything because of the three appointment we have tomorrow. Lift up those hands and tell the Lord, show me your ways. I am lifting up my hands as a symbolic sign of total surrender, total yieldedness, total submission, brokenness. Yesterday we were saying that our victory is dependent on what Christ has done, but the manifestation of that victory is dependent upon what the Spirit of God is doing. I'll take that again. Our victory, our position, positionally at the right hand of the Father, is predicated upon what Christ has already done. But the manifestation of that power, that victory, that position is based upon what the Spirit is doing through a broken vessel, through a yielded vessel. If you are not yielded, if you are not broken, even though Christ has already paid the price, the manifestation will not be yours.
Papa, where me ye dig in my Jehovah, have your way in my life, not my way, not the way of the world, not even some of my ways, all of your ways, Father, all of your ways. Can you lay your hand, your right hand over your chest? as a contact point to your heart. The summary of what we have been saying is a heart matter. Yesterday we ended with a doing matter. Go and do likewise. Your problem is not knowing the word of God. You already know it, but it's a doing matter. The man tried to justify himself. Christ gave him a parable. When he answered correctly, Christ said, go and do likewise. So it's the same thing. It's a doing matter. Tell the Lord, circumcise my heart. Because the reason why Israelites fell in the desert, the reason why many of them did not enter, God said they didn't know his ways, and it was a matter of the heart. So let this be the second prayer point before we bring out our prayer request. Tell the Lord, circumcise my heart. Let it be a deep circumcision. Remember what I told you, a little bit of medicine I taught you. In medicine, we have superficial surgery. You just incise a ball, you drain the pus. But when it is cancer, you do radical surgery. You don't just circumcise to drain the pus. You shell out the cell, every tissue there. So tell the Lord, do radical surgery in my heart. I'm not just looking for superficial surgery. I don't want Vaseline anointing in 2022. I want the real thing. Monarch of Zion, dig deep. Go deep into my heart. Bring out your divine scalpel. Dig deep. Shell out every purpose, every deposit, anything that will not help me this 2022. Tell the Lord, hey, do radical surgery. Just like my wife, she was asking me in the morning or yesterday as she was driving up the prayer. Tell the Lord, this 2022, I don't want people who will quench my spiritual fire. Bring people around me who will even catapult me more. Let me not go with friends who will quench me. I want friends who will pick me up. Friends that will fire me up. Friends that will tell me you need to pray. Friends that will tell me you need to pray. You need to rise up. You need to read the word. Talk to the Lord. Talk to the Lord. Talk to the Lord. Talk to the Lord. Give the Lord to do surgery in your heart. Jesus, name it, change my heart, oh Lord, make it ever true. Change my heart, oh Lord, may I be like you. Sing with me. Change my heart, oh Lord. Change my heart, let me be like you. Father, let me be like you. You are the potter, I am the clay. You are the potter, Father, I am declared. Change my heart, O Lord. Change my heart, O Lord. Change my heart, O Lord. As you bring it out, remember we said you should duplicate it. You will drop one copy here in the prayer basket. You hold back the second copy you will be using to tick as the year progresses and the Lord is doing those things. When you do that, open your Bible to Deuteronomy chapter 26. You raise your prayer list up. Raise both of them. Open to Deuteronomy chapter 26. Please, let's be a little bit fast so that I will not have to delay you, even though by the grace of God, the boss will come. We believe the boss will come. It came yesterday. So just bring out your two prayer lists, separate them so that when it is time, you will drop one and hold back. And then you open your Bibles to Deuteronomy chapter 26. Deuteronomy chapter 26. Praise the Lord. I said, praise the Lord. Can you please stand up? We usually do this on Saturday, so it gives us all the time. But tomorrow is loaded, so we don't have to have all the time for the testimonies and testimonials. Triple dose attitude of gratitude. Can you please stand up? Can you please stand up and lift up those prayer requests? Please, if you have not duplicated it, duplicate it. You hold back one copy so that as the months and weeks and days are unfolding, you will be ticking out. I believe God that He will answer all our prayers in Jesus' name. Can you please stand up if you have opened your Bible to Deuteronomy chapter 26? Deuteronomy chapter 26. Can you go back? Put your hand there. Let's read again where we read in chapter 29. Before we go to chapter 26, where we read in chapter 29. So put your hand or paper or pencil in chapter 26, then go to chapter 29, verse 12 to 14. Can we be standing, please? Can we be standing? Can we be standing? Verse 12 of Deuteronomy chapter 29. Sorry that I am rushing it. It's because I want to release your time. You are standing here. If you are not standing, please, can you stand up? Because that's what the Bible says. You are standing here in order to enter into a covenant with the Lord your God. A covenant the Lord is making with you this day and sealing with an oath to confirm you this day as His people, that He may be your God, as He swore, as He promised you, and as He swore to your fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Today, the promise is made through Jesus Christ. So we are standing under the banner of the blood of Jesus Christ in the Messianic covenant, not the old covenant. We only read there to give us a proper platform. Can we now open to chapter 26 of Deuteronomy? Are we there? Are we there? You are representing yourself and your family. That's what it says if we had read down. Okay, let's finish reading verse 14, please. Can you go back to chapter 29 so that we'll all be in agreement? Verse 14, I am making this covenant with His oath, not only with you who are standing here with us today in the presence of the Lord our God, but also with those who are not here today. Are you in agreement that you are representing your family? Are you in agreement you are representing them? Because time and space and distance are no barrier to God. Now, with your own lips, you verbalize it because it's a matter of choice. If you are not in agreement, don't verbalize what you are going to read in verse chapter 26. Can we go to verse 17, 18, and 19? I will read from verse 16. The Lord your God commands you this day to follow these decrees and laws. Carefully observe them with all your heart again, and with all your soul. Now, verse 17 and 18,
If I read, if any point you are in agreement, you say amen. If you are not in agreement, don't say amen. Verse 17, you are declaring this day that the Lord is your God. Excuse me. Praise the Lord. Is Jehovah your God?
Yes.
Praise the Lord. I'll read that again. Verse 17. You are declaring this day that the Lord is your God.
Amen.
And that you will walk in his ways.
Amen.
And that you will keep his decrees.
Amen.
His commands.
Amen.
And his laws.
Amen.
And that you will obey him.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Now, this is what the Lord is now telling you in verse 18 and 19. And the Lord is declaring this day that you are his people.
Amen.
His treasured possession.
Amen.
And that you have to keep all his commandments.
Amen.
He is declaring this day that he will set you in praise.
Amen.
In faith.
Amen.
In honor.
Amen.
High above all your neighbors.
Amen.
And he will make you the first and not the last.
Amen.
The head and not the tail.
Amen.
You will be a people holy to the Lord your God as he has promised.
Amen.
In the name of the Father.
Amen.
And of the Son.
Amen.
And of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. So,
turn verses 17 and 18 and 19 into a personal prayer. Open your mouth, and pray. Open your mouth and pray. Say the one that is your part and claim the one that is God's part. Emo kapra lenga sanga lele brole baba. Sambra lenga lele baba gale brole baba. Sangra lenga baba manga bobo manga lele baba. Sambra lenga lele brale baba. Yes, Father of Light, Lord, I'm declaring this day that you, Jehovah, you are my God, and that I will walk in your ways, that I will keep your decrees, your commands, and your laws, and that I will obey you. And Lord, I am receiving by faith your own promise that you, Jehovah, you are declaring this day that I am your people, I am your treasured possession as you have promised, and that in agreement I have agreed to keep all your commands. Father, you are declaring and you have declared this day that you set me on high in praise, in fame, in honor, high above all the nations you have made, and that you will be, I will be a people holding on to you. Thank you, Father. I receive it by faith. Blessed be your holy name, Lord and King of Kings, in the mighty name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Now lift up that prayer list, both of them, as a wave offering. Tell the Lord, this is my request. This is my heart desire for what I desire you to do for me this year, 2022. I am believing you. You have been answering prayers in the past. I am believing you that this year you will do exceedingly abundantly above all I've even written here. All above all I can imagine. Let your name be glorified. I am trusting, Lord, that you and you alone, you will make it make manifest. If you like, it's a prophetic action. It's not a magic formula. You can turn to the east. That's the east behind, in front of me there. You turn to the west and pray it. You turn to the south. You turn to the north. You raise your hands up to the heavens. You speak it into the heavenlies, into the chambers of the sun and the moon and the stars, that you are making this declaration unto the Lord, to the Lord this day, and you are claiming his own promise in verse 18 and 19 for yourself and members of your family. Akole brale baba baba mangale brale baba rangale le brale baba baba mangale bro zimbrale ka baba kia le brale baba baba mangale grade baba kago kaka le kale brale zimbrale kale baba baba kaba le bro zengrale ka baba baba mangale bro. Nothing is too small to ask God. Nothing is too big to ask God. Believe God. Whatever you have asked of him, he is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all you can ask or imagine. Be glorified, Lord. Be exalted. Be magnified. Thank you, Father. Just spend the next 2-3 minutes praying in the Spirit. Praying over as you keep on waving it as a wave offering. Pray in the Spirit. Open your mouth and pray in the Spirit. What you cannot pray, let Holy Spirit pray for you.
In Jesus' name we pray. In Jesus' name we pray. Now, there is a part I forgot yesterday to remind us. I've been forgetting it today. But you already know BTM. We are not putting money first. But if you are led to sow a seed of faith in line with what you are asking of God, by faith that is a big God, and by faith that he has already answered, you're only waiting for the manifestation. If you have it, attach it to one of the copies you are going to drop into the basket. If you don't have it, you want to make it as a pledge, just write it at the last line of that your prayer request. Write your name, write your phone number so that we can make contact. And then you can also write how you are going to, when you are going to redeem the pledge. If you have it now, attach it, separate the two copies, attach your covenant seed. It's a seed of faith. You are not bribing God. You are not paying for his blessing. We never promote that in BTM. Attach it, the copy you want to drop in the basket. When you drop it later, we'll sort it out. If you don't have it, you want to make it as a pledge, you can write it in as part of the prayer, this thing, or write a piece of paper so that as you are dropping it, you drop all of them. We'll sort it out later. I'm the only person who has access to the basket until the next covenant seminar. So feel free to write your name or number and the pledge. Immediately we finish this night, I seal it, and nobody opens it. In fact, most of the time, I sort it out myself. Nobody opens the basket until the next covenant seminar. So feel very free to write it. If you have it now, attach it. If you don't have it, write as a pledge. And then if you have a time lag to redeem it tomorrow as you are coming, if you have it, there'll be time for you to drop it in the basket. God will bless you. Please, it is not, you are not paying for your miracle. We don't promote that. It's not biblical. You're only saying, God, this is seed of faith. I am sowing in faith because I believe that you have already answered. Thank you, Father. When you finish, can you just stand up and come and drop your prayer request and the pledge inside here? We still have just one more prayer. The contact point. Hold your contact point. Later we pray. But come and drop your prayer request here with the pledge or with whatever. God will bless you. Can you just come forward? Can you just come forward? Time is gone. Drop the prayer request. If you have the pledge, drop it also. We'll sort it out later.
There is no one like you, Alpha and Omega.
There is
no one like you.
Hallelujah.
Calling and keeping God. There is no one like you. You are the Alpha and Omega. There is no one like you. Oh, and I'm keeping God. There is no one like you. You are the Alpha and Omega. There is no one like you. You are the Alpha and keeping Father. There is no one like you, God. You are the Alpha and Omega. There is no one like you. You're the God of
God. In Jesus' name we pray. Can you lift up your hand and wave to the Lord? We still have one prayer point. Your contact. Thank you, Father. Please, those who are watching online, a WhatsApp number will be put up on the screen.
so that you can send your own prayer request to that WhatsApp number, please. And maybe another number can be put so that if you have a seed to sow, you can also access the bank account of the ministry and sow your seed. Are we happy? Can you lift up your hand one more time? Speak it. So he will be man, take care. So you see, you find it in Proverbs for that you believe God, your chains are gone. You are waiting for the manifest, but declares that you, everything that was a bad was a hurt, everything that was a hurt. Please, I am forgotten the next 7 minutes we have left here. Please, but I'm led to for us to specifically pray one more time against those four spirits we prayed against in September. The spirit of retardation. Coming up recurrently for many months now, if you have been attending. Don't say we have prayed it before. God never does anything for the sake of just doing anything. But there are no
The questions we asked, one of them was, are you the one to come? Are you the one that will manifest in your family, in your community, in your state, in this nation? If you are that one, we want to draw the straight line to change things in your family, or are we expecting a better way?
Yes.
Bring out your contact point. Bring out the contact point. Whatever represents your profession, your life's endeavor. Lord, I was no other way we walk, but that way he wants to do it. If you obey him, even if it's just take that stick, throw it into the water, Mara will become sweet. It will happen. Praise the Lord. Second Corinthians, no begin. In all things, at all times, having all that you need. There are five alls there. I'll read it again in English. Second Corinthians. All great Monday to Saturday or Sunday, January to December, having all that you need, not so you will abound in every good work. Can you lift up that counterpoint, Father? according to your prophetic word unto us. We believe it's right, okay. Your grace will be more than enough on Monday through Sunday, from January to December, whether we are going out or we are coming in our profession, in our academic. On Thursday, on Friday, on Saturday, on Sunday, from January, this January we are into December, you shall be well with me. On a K package day, on Ori, on Alpha, on God, on my children, on my wife, you are blessed of the Lord. Say it with conviction. Say, hands, you are blessed of the Lord.
You are blessed
on this covenant renewal day. God has a anointed you from this anointed shall bring me blessings,
shall bring me
joy,
shall bring me
peace,
shall bring me
unction to function in the name of Jesus.
The name of
Jesus. Are you in agreement?
Yes.
Can you say amen?
Amen.
In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Do you believe God?
Yes.
Can you do that, our common prophetic action? Just turn around and say, I can see everything. Why I forgave you is because time has gone. If not, some of you didn't do it the way. Our last hallelujah, you'll be jumping up, you'll be clapping your hand above your head,